Hello friends, this is the last class on dementia. So let us learn about the other causes of dementia. In our last classes, we have learned about, so let us now learn about the differential diagnosis of dementia. In our last classes about dementia, we have learned about number 1, Alzheimer's disease. And then we have learned about vascular dementia, which is next more common. In this vascular dementia, we have learned about two things, if you remember. One is multi-infarct dementia and the other one is white matter disease or leukoerosis, white matter disease. And then we have learned about progressive supranuclear palsy. And we have also learned with one more, frontotemporal dementia. And then we have learned about corticobasal degeneration. And in our last class, we have learned about Parkinson's disease dementia. And dementia with Lewy bodies. So these are the differential diagnoses of dementia which we have learned in our last class. So now let us learn about the new differential diagnosis of dementia. So in this lesson, let us learn about the new differential diagnosis of dementia, which are number 1, Creutzfeldt Jakob disease. So this is a prion disease where there is dementia and cortical signs, rigidity and myoclonus. So these are the major features. Here you have EEG changes. EEG shows periodic complexes. Whereas in Alzheimer's disease, EEG is non-specific slowing is seen. And then in MRI, which is diffusion weighted MRI, in diffusion weighted MRI, you see cortical ribbon and basal ganglia hyperintensities. So this is something which you see on MR. So by that you can differentiate between the Creutzfeldt-Jakobson disease and Alzheimer's disease. So the next type of dementia which is seen is Huntington disease. So Huntington's disease is the predominant neurodegenerative disorder, which is basically involving chorea, is the first thing. First chorea, and then there is behavioral disorder and executive impairment. The features of what we see, we will see in our next class after Parkinsonism, so that it becomes easier. And then there is one more differential diagnosis, which is normal pressure hydrocephalus. This is very uncommon, and even this can lead to dementia. And then other causes like chronic alcoholism, and then there is one more disease where dementia occurs, dementia with seizures, with degeneration of corpus callosum is seen. This is called as a disease which is called as Marchia Fava Bignami disease. This is mainly reported in Italian red wine drinkers. In Italian red wine drinkers, you see this disease, which is dementia with seizures and degeneration of corpus callosum. Right? And then it is also seen in, dementia is also seen in vitamin B1 deficiency, that is thiamine deficiency, which is called as Wernicke's encephalopathy. The features of Wernicke's encephalopathy we will learn in that specific class. Right? Then, even whenever there is prolonged B1 deficiency, this leads to a Korsakoff syndrome, where there is dementia, or amnestic syndrome. Here, the patient is unable to recall new memory, new information, but already old memory is normal. Unable to recall new information. There is normal memory or attention span. Immediate memory is normal. So he cannot store the information more than a few minutes. That is the major difficulty here. So we will learn about it detail in its respective class. And then vitamin B12 deficiency can also lead to this. And deficiency of nicotinic acid or decreased folate levels. Sometimes CNS infections and also neurosyphilis. And then whenever the neoplasms of CNS, even this can lead to that, but there are seizures and some headache and some other features for it also. And there is a syndrome which is called as paraneoplastic syndrome of dementia. It is associated with small cell lung cancer, and thus it is called as limbic encephalitis or paraneoplastic encephalitis. So here there are antibodies to NMDA receptor. So this leads to memory loss, seizures or agitation, emotional changes. Right, all these can be seen. So that is what is called as paraneoplastic syndrome of dementia. We will learn about it in our later classes when we deal with respective syndromes. Even in systemic diseases like hypothyroidism, then vasculitis, hepatic, renal and pulmonary diseases also, there is chances of this dementia. And whenever there is hepatic encephalopathy, then metal exposure like arsenic, lead, mercury, aluminium poisoning, all these can also lead to dementia. Right? and whenever there is recurrent head trauma, subdural hematoma, right? And there is also a disease which is called as transient global amnesia. This is sudden severe episodic memory loss. It occurs after 50 years of age. So there is one more disease which is amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, Parkinsonism, or dementia complex of Guam. This is seen in the island of Guam, so it is named as this. And there may be adult onset leukodystrophy and then CADASIL adrenoleukodystrophy. Okay, all these are the differential diagnoses. There are lots and lots of differential diagnoses, right? And then there is also neuronal ceroid lipofuscinosis. There is event specific amnesia. And then there is more prolonged psychogenic amnesia. And also psychiatric diseases. So there is a condition which is called as pseudo-dementia. So in pseudo-dementia, because they are severely depressed or anxious, they appear to be demented. So this is pseudo-dementia. And then there may be schizophrenia. This may also be associated with dementia. We will learn about schizophrenia in our psychiatry lectures. And these are the, lots of differential diagnoses in this dementia. So this dementia which is there, all the differential diagnosis of dementia is given as a box form in Harrison. It is good to just take a look at that box so that it is easier for you to understand. And then you can watch my videos later. And now, what are the evaluations? So, a person has come to you with some form of dementia. Then, how do you evaluate it? Evaluation of dementia. So, first, you do routine examination. In routine examination, you will have to take, number one, history. And then, you do physical examination. And then, you do lab tests like thyroid function test, TSH and vitamin B12 and complete blood picture to rule out if any infection, and also electrolytes can be done, right? And then you can do CT or MRI if it is if you feel that there are history which suggests whether Alzheimer's disease or some degeneration, then you can do CT or MRI. Then you can do liver function tests and renal function tests to rule out renal and liver failure. And then for neurosyphilis, you can do VDRL. That if you feel, even you will have to have the history regarding this neurosyphilis, right? And then other helpful tests, like you can do EEG, parathyroid, These are used occasionally. And you can do heavy metals urine, heavy metals if you suspect any poisons, right? And you can do RBC sedimentation rate. If you feel any angiogram, if it is related to any blood vessels, then you can do angiogram. Brain biopsy, we don't do it much. And you can even do PET scan if you feel any tumors are there. Right, so these are the major routine evaluation which you do for dementia. So once you evaluate for dementia, mostly, you know, the only the outer external appearance will differentiate it, and from external appearance you can go through the tests and history mostly differentiates in every type of dementia. As I have said, there is difference in history from each and every type of dementia. So based on that, you can differentiate. And treatment of dementia, it is mainly symptomatic treatment. So you have to you have to first treat the underlying cause. If it's due to infection, vitamin B12 deficiency or something, you will have to first treat the underlying cause. So let me write two or three sentences about treatment of dementia. For treating dementia, first, treat underlying cause, number one. That is important, you know. All the underlying causes should be treated. And then also remove cognition-impairing drugs. Any drugs or medication which impair cognitive function should be removed. So if the patient has depression, then give antidepressants. In the antidepressants, we generally give SSRIs. And if they have behavioral problems, it's just symptomatic. You know, if they have behavioral problems, then you will have to give phenothiazines and benzodiazepines. If the patient has psychosis, agitation, aggression, in these patients you can give second generation antipsychotics, which is quetiapine. Right? All these can be given. So if you feel the patient has Alzheimer's disease, so always give cholinesterases. Okay, anticholinesterase, sorry. Like anticholinesterase, like donepezil, rivastigmin, galantamine. And you can also give memantine. Right? So all this is the caregiver. Giving caregiver is the important thing in dementia. So this is the end of the class on dementia, guys. Thank you guys for watching my lectures. If you feel something is inadequate in this lecture, or if you feel I should add something in this lecture, please comment it in the comment section. If you have any doubts, even then comment it in the comment section. Thank you guys for watching my lectures. Thank you very much. Thank you.